Mark's name came up, and I remember at the time I was very impressed with the Madonna Rain video. Not appropriate for me necessarily, but if someone could do that with that track, what could they do in my track? And well, I found out it was rotten meat.
I really wanted to get back to a more visceral, simpler experience of filmmaking.
The sense I got working with Mark was that it was less him being hired to do a job for me, and it was more two artists coming together, meeting at something that took it beyond what each component could have been on its own.
You know, that image of the woman with the eggs balanced and spinning on her fingertips, that's actually a detail, a tiny detail from a really complicated painting by Rudolf Hausner. And I showed that painting to Trent Reznor, and he said, well, do you think she should be nude? And I said, well, yeah, if we're trying to achieve this quality of like a Jungian dream or something, you know, she should be nude. You wouldn't censor something like that in a dream. And he said, well, I think she should be nude. And I said, well, MTV's not going to show that. And he said, I don't give a fuck whether MTV will show this or not. Some people don't want to compromise. And those are the people that I enjoy collaborating with.
When you walked in and saw the sets that this took place in, it looked fantastic. And it wasn't, well, on film it's going to look better. It looked great as it did. Everything really was done with extreme attention to detail.
The idea of making this kind of archaic looking imagery to that kind of industrial pop music was a pretty weird idea at the time. We shot that on these Bell & Howell hand crank cameras, and there were no video taps. I had really no exact idea of what the framing was. There was a lot of times when we opened up the camera and like the film sprang out of it like a Jack in the Box.
It was an intense kind of environment. You know, we got good work done, but no one had their feet up.
And we, you know, sprayed condensed air in his cheeks, and we put ball gags in his mouth, and I chained him up on real handcuffs that were cutting into his wrist. You know, I would become so enraptured by the image that I just left him spinning up there for like 60 seconds, and Trent kind of wobbled over to a trash can in the corner and puked. But once again, it was an example of me torturing an artist in order to try to make something that I thought was going to be memorable. The monkey was not harmed. This is very important to me because I love animals. There was an ASPCA person on the set watching. That species of monkey has this sort of tick where it grimaces, so when we used those pieces, it looked like it was in distress, but the monkey was not hurt. The pig was harmed, obviously.
The smell of this dead, rotting animal corpse just filled the whole stage almost instantly, and it was debilitating. You practically couldn't work, yet we had to keep working.
You know, all the damage and distress on that film, I did myself. We sprayed aerosol shellac, and I took a lighter and melted the film, and we dragged it around in the parking lot. That idea of being like touching the film again, it was really regenerative to experience making that video. You know, you don't get the opportunity that often to be subversive to the extent that you really are going to have a kind of censorship problem with MTV.
From the beginning, there were some shots that got cut out, the monkey on the cross, the nudity, obviously. They couldn't show my hands in bondage.
We had attached a plastic crucified Jesus to the mask, and MTV said, well, don't cut out the shot, but just erase the Jesus. They wanted the hand of their censorship to be invisible.
It took it from one place in my head to a place setting that didn't literally define anything, but set a tone that made the song sound better to me. And I think that's an achievement. You know, it's one I've yet to recreate again.
I'm really grateful for that freedom that Trent gave me at that moment. And I wouldn't have made the Jay-Z video the same way. I certainly wouldn't have made the Johnny Cash video the same way.
He had wanted to do a video for Johnny for a long time, and it just had never worked out before. And after hearing the new album, he called me and he said, I have to do a video, I have to do Hurt, and we need to make this happen.
I was like virtually threatening Rick, who is now like one of my best friends. I said, I am doing a video for that track.
Johnny had a little finite window of time that he could make the video at home, and Mark said, well, I'll just figure something out. Mark was concerned about, you know, if it works out that all I do is have him well lit in a chair singing the song. He said, I don't know if that's going to be enough to carry the video, and I'm not sure what I'm going to do.
As we were touring the House of Cash Museum, they said, you know, here's the film storage room. where stacks and stacks of film cans and all of Johnny's television shows and all of his films, anything that had ever been shot was in this room. But I didn't think we were going to use it. So we cut together the video using the performances of Johnny and the stuff from the House of Cash. And it was good. It was pretty good. And we said, well, maybe we should look at this archival stuff. Let's see what the hell we have in these boxes. And we pulled out something and loaded it up into the computer. And I think it happened to be that image of Johnny riding the train. And my editor, Robert Duffy, I literally somewhat randomly dropped it into the cut. And we got chills went up our spine. And there was something about the juxtaposition of Johnny as a young, vibrant man and Johnny towards the end of his life that was, we knew something really powerful was going on there. And I showed the video to Rick, and Rick was like, holy shit, in a good and bad way.
It really upset me, and it really affected me, and I thought it was beautiful, but it was so unlike any video I'd seen before, and so extreme, that it really took my breath away, and not in a good way. I didn't know how to handle it. It was just overwhelming.
I remember I was doing a session with a friend of mine, and this video shows up in the mail. And it was the beginning of the day, and the video's there, and I said, oh, let's put this in and see what it is. But I knew it was Mark's version of the video. And what I wasn't prepared for was what I saw, and it really then wasn't my song anymore, you know? And really, tears welling up, kind of everyone silent. Silence at the end of the video, and a lot of wow.
That video made me cry, and that's not common.
What threw me about Hurt was that it was like a bonfire of vanities. His and Johnny Cash.
It was almost too sad, but beautifully done. I have mixed feelings about it. I'd have to see it again, I guess, but I don't really want to see it again.
When I saw the video, then the song completely was goosebumps up the spine. Unbelievably powerful piece of work.
Trent Reznor was born to write that song, but Johnny Cash was born to sing it. And Mark Romanek was born to film it.
To be able to do a piece of work that is that powerful, that rises so outside of the genre of what it is, for me was phenomenal. The power of that video is something that I can barely talk about on camera. It really had a profound impact on me.
The fact that in a 4-minute video, that level of emotion can be brought out of the viewer is incredible. I mean, if you felt that much emotion during a 2-hour movie, it would be a good accomplishment.
Videos aren't meant to have that kind of emotional engagement. And it's like most people don't have those aspirations for a video. It's just not the agenda to move people deeply. You're really just trying to entertain them, or it's supposed to be eye candy. But to deeply move someone with a music video, that never comes up, you know? And it wasn't our intention. We didn't say, wow, we're going to really move people. But boy, were people moved. Away.